This week on Maker Update, a robot to knock over your coffee, a plastic trombone powered by CircuitPython, powering your workshop with RFID, giant foam pumpkins, plastic restoration, slush casting, and searching for hidden gems on AliExpress. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update. I'm Tyler Weingarner and I hope you're all doing great. I don't know about you, but around here, it seems like summer just got up and left in a big hurry. It's nice to feel some crisper weather again, but it's also a great reminder that Halloween is right around the corner. We've got some spooky projects for you later on in the show if you need some ideas. But in the meantime, let's check out the project of the week. Do you remember a good while back when we featured a 3D printed harmonic drive on this show? It was definitely one of those projects that opened my eyes to some new engineering possibilities, even though I didn't really realize its practical applications. Well, it turns out one of its practical applications is this. 3D Printed Life took their harmonic drive, added some refinements, and used them to create a fairly compact but strong 6-axis 3D printed robot arm, with the intent of using it to move their camera in space. They have a few constraints in mind as well. Of course, it needs to be able to move their camera, so it has to comfortably lift a little over a kilogram. And they also wanted it to come in under a $500 budget. Along the way, there's a ton of great tips, like using carbon fiber rods to join very large parts together in a way that makes them easier to print and add strength while keeping them light. There's also a good one for adding a stiff interface between shafts and 3D printed parts. If you just pop the top off of one of these GT2 pulleys, you can press fit it into a 3D printed part with matching teeth and get a reliable, no-slip interface. There's also a tiny bit about the complex mathematics of inverse kinematics. That's where you can tell the robot's end effector to move to a specific point in space, and then the code does all the hard work to tell each motor how far to turn to get it there. They stare a little bit into that complex void, and then back off to a simpler version so they could have a working robot by the end of this video. They also created their own micronized version of the Feather M4, with more robust power management, a smaller footprint, and avoiding some of the chip shortage issues. Let's hear it for open hardware. But by the end, they got what they set out to do. There's still some stuff to get worked out, like how the wrist joint needs some additional strengthening. And there's some stutter coming from the harmonic drives. But it's a long way from just a simple, compact gearing mechanism. And it looks great too. If you're interested in working on this project by yourself, they share a GitHub repo with all the necessary code and files. More projects. Depending on how much you keep up with ridiculous video game news, you may have heard about Trombone Champ, a game that lets you relive your high school band brass section dreams. Liz Clark and Katni Rambor from Adafruit teamed up to make this 3D printed custom controller for the game. A slide potentiometer that moves with the 3D printed trombone slide adjusts the pitch of the instrument, and the light up arcade button on the back lets you toot your way to victory. CircuitPython's HID emulation makes it easy to interface with your computer as a control device. It's maybe a little silly, but hey, custom controllers make any music game better, right? On Instructables, I found this great workshop safety project by Taste the Code. Its execution is simple enough. An Arduino Nano reads the input from an RFID tag reader, and depending on the tag presented, it triggers a relay. That relay controls a much larger electrical switch called a contactor. A contactor can carry much heavier loads than a relay, enough so that he can comfortably run all of his workshop's electricals through the contactor, effectively cut enough power unless the correct RFID tag is present. Whether you've ever wondered how to use software to control high electrical loads or how to work with RFID tags, check this one out. Also on Instructables, I found this guide for an automated slide digitizer by RBWood53. This makes use of an old carousel-style slide projector. You remove the lens and the projector lamp, and replace them with this tiny 3D printed backlit projector screen. A digital camera then photographs the slide image projected onto this screen to digitize the image. An Arduino Nano living in a control box manages the advancement of the slides, it triggers the camera, the whole lot. The best part is, all of the modifications made to the slide projector are reversible, so you don't need to cannibalize a piece of classic hardware to try this one out. And finally, we have a great tutorial for making this oversized foam jack-o'-lantern by Haunted Spider. Just like any other project this size, you can't just take the same approach as a normal-sized one and scale it up. Using a collection of styrofoam blocks he got for free from Tractor Supply, he created the entire thing like a segmented bowl. And then he used the offcut wedges to add a little more roundness to the vertical surfaces. From there, it's a whole lot of carving, filling, sealing, vacuuming the lawn, and painting. The wonderful final touch is adding a giant carving knife to the skeleton hand next to it. Time for some tips and tools. On his channel, Great Scott has plumbed the depths of AliExpress to try and find some hidden gems that make the long shipping times worth the while. His first hit was a supercapacitor power filter, which can be used to reduce low voltage noise commonly associated with amplifiers. There's also a super efficient lithium battery charger that can be had for just 70 cents. There's also a handful of drill powered attachments like a jigsaw and a mini chainsaw. There's a few misses too, like this hand crank generator. If you're looking for a kickstart to your Halloween costume, check out these 3D printable Techgogs from Cyberpunk 2077 by smiteorflight. There's two versions of this print. One is completely enclosed and probably better suited for cosplay photoshoots where maybe you don't need to see. The other has an open front and is designed so you can cover the opening with neutral density lighting gels. It'll make it so the inner workings and your eyes won't be seen from the outside, but you can still see to get around. Both have recesses for 5mm LEDs and coin cell batteries, so they get that signature spider eye look. Adam Savage is in the process of restoring a Nagra 4S audio recorder. Part of the restoration involves rejuvenating the plastic lid, which has gotten a little cloudy and yellowed with age. First step is to knock down the cloudiness with some plastic polish, which he just works over all of the surfaces by hand, like literally with his fingers. To take the yellow down, he lets it soak in a solution of 12% hydrogen peroxide overnight. The peroxide still left some of the yellowing behind, but after a second polish using an electric polisher, he's made a remarkable improvement. Restoration like this is a tricky business, and it can easily go bad on you, so it's nice to see a thorough video of the process. Speaking of thorough videos, Robert Tolone has a fantastic video about slush casting. This is a super quick casting process where you rotate the mold by hand to get the resin to coat the detail areas of your mold while it's still curing. But there's a ton of other tips in here too. This one for brushing on your silicone in areas of the master part where bubbles are likely to form is something I've never seen before. I'd also never seen using waxed cardboard as a mold container before. This video is full of great techniques from someone who's obviously been doing this for a while. For this week's Digi-Key Spotlight, they've got a quick primer on how fiber optic cables work. I thought I knew most of what there was to know about fiber optics, but I had no idea that multimode cables existed, which are larger diameter cables that can pass multiple signals that operate on different phases. I was also really excited to see these breadboard breakouts for fiber optic cables. Could be fun to use these in an upcoming project. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, be sure to subscribe, give us a thumbs up, and leave us a comment. It's always great to hear from you guys. As always, great big thanks to Digi-Key Electronics for making this whole show possible, and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.